The SOT-WEED Factor by John Barth. Part 1, The Momentous Wager. Chapter 1, The Poet is Introduced and Differentiated from His Fellows. In the last years of the 17th century, there was to be found among the fops and fools of the London coffeehouses one rangy, gangling flitch called Ebenezer Cook, more ambitious than talented, and yet more talented than prudent, who, like his friends in folly, all of whom were supposed to be educating at Oxford or Cambridge, had found the sound of Mother English more fun to game with than her sense to labour over, and so rather than applying himself to the pains of scholarship, had learned the knack of versifying, and ground out choirs of couplets after the fashion of the day, a froth with Joves and Jupiters, a clang with jarring rhymes, and string taut with similes stretched to the snapping point. As poet, this Ebenezer was not better nor worse than his fellows, none of whom left behind him anything nobler than his own posterity. But four things marked him off from them. The first was his appearance. Pale-haired and pale-eyed, raw-boned and gaunt-cheeked, he stood, nay, angled, 19 hands high. His clothes were good stuff, well-tailored, but they hung on his frame like luffed sails on long spars. Heron of a man, lean-limbed and long-billed, he walked and sat with loose-jointed poise. His every stance was angular surprise, his each gesture half-flail. Moreover, there was a discomposure about his face, as though his features got on ill together. Heron's beak, wolf, hound's forehead, pointed chin, lantern jaw, wash-blue eyes, and bony blonde brows had minds of their own, went their own ways, and took up odd stances. They moved each independent of the rest, and fell into new configurations, which often does not have no relation to what one took as his mood of the moment. And these configurations were short-lived, for like restless mallards, the features of his face no sooner were settled than, ha, they'd be flushed, and hi, how they'd flutter every man for himself, and no man could say what lay behind them. The second was his age. Whereas most of his accomplices were scarce turned 20, Ebenezer at the time of this chapter was more nearly 30, yet not a whit more wise than they, and with 6 or 7 years less excuse for sharing their folly. The third was his origin. Ebenezer was born American, though he'd not seen his birthplace since earliest childhood. His father, Andrew Cook II of the parish of St. Giles in the Fields, county of Middlesex, a red-faced, white-chopped, stout-winded old lecher with flinty eye and withered arm, had spent his youth in Maryland as agent for a British manufacturer, and as had his father before him, and having a sharp eye for goods and a sharper for men, had added to the Cook estate by the time he was 30 some 1,000 acres of good wood and arable land on the Choptank River. The point on which this land lay he called Cook's Point, and the small manor house he built there, Malden. He married late in life and conceived twin children, Ebenezer and his sister Anna, whose mother, as if such an inordinate casting had cracked the mould, died bearing them. When the twins were but four, Andrew returned to England, leaving Malden in the hands of an overseer, and thenceforth employed himself as a merchant, sending his own factors to the plantation. His affairs prospered, and the children were well provided for. The fourth thing that distinguished Ebenezer from his coffeehouse associates was his manner. Though not one of them was blessed with more talent than he needed, all of Ebenezer's friends put on great airs when together, declaiming their verses, denigrating all the well-known poets of their time and any members of their own circle who happened to be not on hand, boasting of their amorous conquests and their prospects for imminent success, and otherwise behaving in a manner such that had not every other table in the coffeehouse sported a like ring of coxcombs, they'd have made great nuisances of themselves. But Ebenezer himself, though his appearance rendered inconspicuousness out of the question, was bent to taciturnity and undemonstrativeness. He was even chilly. Except for infrequent bursts of garrulity, he rarely joined in the talk, but seemed content for the most part simply to watch the other birds preen their feathers. Some took this withdrawal as a sign of his contempt, and so were either intimidated or angered by it, according to the degree of their own self-confidence. Others took it for modesty, others for shyness, others for artistic or philosophical detachment. Had it been, in fact, symptom of any one of these, there would be no tale to tell. In truth, however, this manner of our poet's grew out of something much more complicated, which well warrants recounting his childhood, his adventures, and his ultimate demise.